I did not hit her. It's not true. It's bullshit. I did not hit her. I did not. Oh, hi, Mark.
Oh, hi, Max.
Very good. Very good.
Very good, Jake.
Hello, and welcome to OSW Review, the old school wrestling video podcast. What's this? A Brucie Bonus, a video review of The Room by your favorite Irish boys. This is your host, Jay Hunter, joined as ever with Mr. Osi.
Hey, do.
And V1.
All right.
As we chronologically critique movies scene by scene. Yes, the Citizen Kane of bad movies by Tommy Wiseau. How did this come about? After our Golden Nogger award-winning episode, Samurai Cop, hopefully. It'll be in two awards, so come on.
Yeah.
Tyler, aka Gamebox from the Invasion podcast, link in the description box below, wanted us to review it, so he threw us a couple of clams to get her done.
Thank you very much.
This is Tyler's legit favorite film.
No, it's not.
It's not actually.
It's his ironic favorite film.
Correct.
But doesn't that like turn into love though? It's like if you like love doing the robot, but it's ironic, but you do it every song, you actually just love doing the robot.
Yeah,
that's
maybe.
Your favorite dance. This is Tyler's legit favorite film. He was having a pretty shitty day at college in Boston, and he was dragged to see it, met comedian Patton Oswalt at the theater, and had the best day. From then on, he brought as many people to see it and even arranged his own screening where Tommy Wiseau showed up.
Fuck off, that's so awesome. Nice. That's amazing.
And now he's spreading that to the OSW multiverse.
The multiverse?
It's infinity bigger than the WWE universe.
Good.
Actually, it's about 1% the size. Yeah. The Room is a 2003 romantic drama written, directed, adapted, produced, bankrolled, and starring Tommy Wiseau.
What a guy.
Besides Wiseau as protagonist Johnny, the film stars Juliette Danielle as his future wife, Lisa, Greg Sestero as his best friend, oh hi Mark, and Philip Haldeman as his young neighbor, Denny. Infamously known as one of the worst films ever made, so bad it's become quite the cult classic. This was supposed to be, obviously, a serious American drama, romantic drama. And later, obviously, it's the biggest joke of a film. So, Tommy Wiseau, he's like, oh, it's a dark comedy. Bollocks.
Bollocks. M. Night. Bollocks.
Yes,
don't you dare bring me into this.
Garnering a generous 3.5 rating on IMDb and 35% fresh rating on Rotten Tomatoes.
Wow.
Let's see why the one theater that originally showed it had signs saying no refunds, and watching this film is like being stabbed in the head. This outside the cinema. Let's find out.
Hi, babe. I have something for you.
What is it?
Just a little something.
Curtain up. Hi, babe! All-round great guy, Tommy brings his girlfriend home a dress. Can't she try it on right now? Sure, it's yours, haha!
Can I try it on now?
Sure, it's yours.
Stop laughing at nothing!
That's going to kill the sexy time mood very quickly.
And by the way, Johnny, he's not a good-looking man. He's quite rubbery.
By the way, Tommy, he works in a bank, so he has a suit. Why has he got such a bad suit? Like, yeah. This is an ill-fitting suit. It's far too big for him.
It's swimming on
this
him.
This is not his suit. This is another member of the cast.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Pretty much all of Tommy's lines are dubbed in this movie. So that means that he had infinite takes to get the perfect line. And they left in what they left in. Oh my God. It's going to be good.
Oh, who's at the door? It's Denny. He's an orphan who Johnny can't adopt, so is paying his rent in his apartment block instead.
Nice to see you, Danny. I'm going to take a nap.
Can I go upstairs too?
Danny, I think I'm going to join him.
What is the Danny character, right? Is he meant to be slow?
I got that impression.
Or has he been so, like, socially guarded that he doesn't know how to talk to real people because his chats with Lisa are frightening. Like he is going to rape you at some point, Lisa. You want to get this lad out of your life as quick as possible.
But maybe he learned English through Tommy Wiseau.
Yeah, oh, I think God. Calling them real people is a bit of a stretch.
Yeah.
It's very complimentary of you, Steve. But I hark back to our happening review. He just picks up an apple and starts eating it. You know, that would annoy me more than him going up the stairs and coming, getting into bed with me.
Really?
Yeah. It's like, how fucking dare you?
This is not your fridge.
Exactly. Ask first.
Yeah, because the rules of like... of biscuits being on a plate does not equal fruit being in a bowl. Because fruit goes in a bowl anyway. So that's just normal. Now, if I took said bowl down from counter and put it in the middle of this table, then...
It's a free-for-all.
It's a free-for-all. Well, no, one. But, that's just knock into someone's room, perv at Johnny's missus, question Johnny on how much he paid for Lisa's new red dress, which is incredibly cheeky to ask that question in front of someone who you're just giving a present to. That's really cunty.
It's very bad.
And then to creep out and perv up the fucking, up to the bedroom.
He just pervs, he doesn't walk.
Oh my God, no, he's like a fucking worm. He just kind of like slithers his way up.
Worms don't make noise.
Sandworms do.
Sandworms do. Yeah.
In Beetlejuice.
Yes.
Oh, sorry. Yes.
But what a fucking creeper. Holy shit. After Danny creeps up to the bedroom, rather than being, what the fuck are you doing? Get the fuck out. They play fight with him in their bed. They actually invite him in to their bed and are like, woo, woo. Play fighting. Like, that is an invitation if I've ever seen one.
Danny, do you have something else to do?
I just like to watch you guys.
Oh, Danny boy.
Poor Danny needs to be placed on some fucking sex offenders list, if you ask me. Like.
Yes, he eventually takes the hint. Tommy's bedroom is a porno set. So straight into a slow motion sex scene. 6 minutes into the film.
What was the song playing? I just have eight words. I will. Do you remember the song? I love these. The three sexing or four sexing
the
songs.
The songs are so bad and cheesy.
They're good though as well. Yeah. It reminds you of...
We're so unaware of how sex works. Gyrates and fucks her belly button.
Belly button. Yeah. Although I'd say it's still better than the sex scenes from Samurai Cop. They were just non-human. This is just like uneducated.
But no, this
he's having
is
to go
silly.
At it. Yeah.
He's got this rose thing. It's like you're going out for 7 years and you're playing with roses and shit.
That doesn't happen.
That doesn't happen after 7 years.
She should know her place after 7 years, and that's in the corner, facing the pillow.
Go like the clapper.
Go like the clappers.
Post coitus, Johnny takes a butt in the moonlight walk, which nobody asked to see.
This sex scene is about Tommy Wiseau. It's not about Johnny and Lisa. It's about me getting my old man hole out to the world.
He then leaves for work to provide for his future wife.
When Johnny wakes up after their sex scene and is going to work, his I have to go now is the worst reading of that line since fucking Poochie. When it's awful.
The alarm goes off. He's like, you know, he has to get up. You've been in bed all fucking day.
Yeah, you've been in bed since you came home. It's like 13 hours of sleep. It's fucking 8:30 in the morning. That's a lie-in for most people.
Exactly.
The titular room is Johnny's living room because a room is a safe place for audiences. In Tommy's safe space, future wife Lisa is talking to her mother, Claudette. Mom lays out that Johnny is the super babyface and Lisa's the heel. You can see Wiseau writing this dialogue like a bitter ex-lover. Like, Tommy, he loves you, supports you, provides for you. He's a wonderful man with a stable job who's getting a promotion soon and will buy you a house, car, and clothes. And what's Lisa's response? Oh, he's too boring.
What a petulant cunt.
I have to say.
Petulant. Get in there.
I have to say, Juliette Danielle, she's either the worst actress in the world or the character is the best actress in the world. Think about it. Like, if she got me convinced that she loved Johnny in the first scene, literally the next scene.
Boom.
Boom.
She confirms her petulant leech heel status by bitching to Tommy's best friend, whatever I do what I will.
But she said, I'm going to do whatever I want to do. What do you think I should do? Man, Jesus, either do what you want to do or get somebody to tell you. Don't fucking try and do both.
I think that's the point, that she doesn't know what she wants. But what she wants to do is him. Why not, Mark? He's busy. Busy sitting in a parked car in the middle of the day.
During this phone call, they say, let's meet up tomorrow. Bing bong, he's fucking there.
I think it is supposed to be tomorrow.
They didn't show a passage of time montage.
A lot of that in this movie.
A lot of that
in this
movie.
A lot of time passes.
Which
except at the end where they have time passing and it's back to the same scene.
So bad.
Yeah, I agree.
Despair not, he comes over and she clumsily seduces him. And then the two bang.
Sex scene number two, we're only 17 minutes in. And this song is quite nice as well. You are my rose, baby. It's pretty good, Jay. Ah. A little spicy there.
Bit of a boys to boys here.
Boys to boys.
This time on the stairs, what'd you make of that? The most comfortable place to play.
Yeah, if I had to choose one place, it would be on the stairs.
Just like you're on the couch, then upstairs is the bed. Why not halfway?
Mark goes out of his way to like try and tell Lisa. He's like, try. He's like, no.
Sorry.
That word is ruined.
Yeah,
forever.
Totally.
You've ruined a word.
Thank you.
That I use every day.
I do try. But like Mark's like, no, Lisa, Johnny is my best friend. I can't cheat on Johnny. Then he's just like, bleh, I'm going to wear the face off you and fuck you on the stairs. And Johnny then stairs. After we finish, I'm going to get guilty again and start giving out to you. Like, you are a cunt. You are every bit as big a cunt as Lisa is.
That's the point I think Tommy's trying to make. Men are vultures and they're awful people. My orphan kid wants to bang my wife. My best mate bangs my wife. One of the lads at the party, he's like, oh, Lisa's so hot, isn't she? It's like everyone is a vulture. They want to bang Lisa and my girlfriend's a whore. You know?
Yeah.
And Tommy, he's the only good guy in the world.
Oh my God.
Lads, is it coming? Is the scene, the scene is
we
next.
Have a milestone in cinema, Steve. The Flare Shop.
Hi, can I help you? Can I have a red... bollocks. Can I have a dozen red roses, please? Oh, hi, Johnny. I didn't know it was you. Here you go. That's me. How much is it? That'll be $18. Here you go. Keep the change. Hi, doggy. You're my favorite customer. Thanks a lot. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. It's manic.
And see. One take. We got it.
What is that? Why did this make this movie?
Clearly, he has a friend who owns a florist. So
clearly.
Who let him use the shop to film a scene in.
Okay.
So that's what I'm thinking. Can you think of any other reason?
Tommy Wiseau is such an egomaniac that he had to put this completely unneeded scene in to just show that Even the florist loves Johnny because Johnny's a great fucking guy.
Her favorite customer.
Yes.
That she didn't recognize.
Who could you get him mixed up for if not Samurai Cop?
And who's a regular customer in a florist's as well? It's all
he just boils the shit out of this cunt.
Kind of deserved it. Kind of had it coming.
Yeah.
You know?
Him?
Yeah.
He's a bit of a loser.
Yeah, a bit of a doormat.
Clearly.
Right? Well, a bit of a doormat maybe. Yeah, yeah.
Do we just turn on the all-round great guy?
I've had my eye on you. Yes, you. And you.
You look beautiful today. Can I kiss you?
You are such a little brat.
Just kidding.
Act 2. Creepo Denny shows up at Lisa's door. Where's Johnny? I want to talk to Johnny. Can I kiss you? Just kidding.
What that was a fuck? Classic. If she says yes, I'll do it. If she says no, I was just kidding. I don't know how people have relationships or, I don't mean friendships or whatever in this world. They only ever talk to each other for about 30 seconds and then I have to go. I'm gone. Oh, hello, bye.
It's the cut and thrust of San Francisco.
Yeah.
Wiseau arrives back from work. Did you get the promotion? Nah. Then they sit down. You didn't get it, did you? What the fuck is that? I am the fool.
Man, Tommy's acting in this scene is particularly horrific.
I don't think I will ever get it. They betrayed me. They didn't keep their promise. They tricked me and I don't care anymore. The bank saves money and they are using me and I am the fool.
I did not get the promotion. Fucking George St. Pierre over here.
Lisa selfishly thinks of herself.
At least you have friends. I didn't get any calls today. You're right. The computer business is too competitive.
They actually do mention that she does have a job, but it doesn't show her going to the job or anything else about it. They just mention that she has clients to see, and that's
it. Oh, remember she said computer stuff. There's no friends in the computer. The computers!
You should keep going to your computer classes. Computers. That's the ticket, Ruby.
The computer business is tough. Is that why you don't have any technology in your house?
Yeah. Oh my goodness.
Although Tommy doesn't drink, Lisa convinces him to forget about it and drink fucking scotch and vodka.
That's some mixer. Drink this if you love me.
Yeah.
That is domestic terrorism right there.
It is.
That's so fucking wrong. And what, like, her reasoning is that if he gets drunk, then he won't be boring, right?
If he gets drunk, maybe he'll hit me.
Yeah. Okay. Because
later on.
Actually,
if he doesn't drink, it's like, I think a lie is more convincing if a part of it is true. So she'll, like, get him drunk and say that he hit her. So if anyone asks, hey, he got drunk and hit me, he'd be like, he doesn't drink. Aha, but he did. So maybe the other part is true.
And then Johnny would question himself, did I? Because he was
Because he was drinking. Right, so okay.
I think that's what they're going for. I'm giving them a...
That actually makes sense. From a booking point of view.
No, it does. But scotch and vodka, sorry.
Scotchka.
Between the two of them, drank...
Two bottles.
An entire... Well, was it two bottles or one bottle?
Well, I'd imagine it was a bottle of whiskey and a bottle of vodka. Yeah.
And they weren't dead.
The third sex scene is Lisa showing off her tits, which is no bad thing. Why are the sex scenes shot like they're from the 90s? The early 90s.
Go on.
With the candles and the rose and the shit and the parallax scrolling in the foreground.
Parallax scrolling?
Like it's fucking Batman Forever on this nest.
Oh my god. They have
the
shit
in front of the screen.
Oh yeah.
They have like a bed in the center of the room and they just shoot around it. And there's like, let's look through the veil and here there's a window with some water on it. Let's look through that.
It actually does have that kind of American sitcom, almost like smoky look over it. You know, that kind of cover the camera in like Vaseline nearly. It just looks really cheap and really nasty.
This is shot in 2002, you know, but it looks 10 years older, you know. Wiseau looks to be penetrating her hip this time.
It's closer.
It's away from the getting there, though.
Is he? I'm not sure about this, but I thought that they reused shots from the first sex scene.
Yes, yeah? They did.
There we go.
These are the same shots from the first sex scene, spliced with its outtakes, as the actress Juliette Danielle refused to be in a second sex scene with him.
Really?
Mm. Why?
Well, he is 25 years older than the actress playing Lisa. She signed up for one sex scene and I'm done now. Like.
And I can't imagine it's that much fun having Mickey rubbed off your belly button and hip.
Yeah. Like I say, if it was up to Tommy, wall-to-wall sex scenes with this girl. that's the movie, you know, for an hour and a half. But is there any way to cover up, like, his willy?
I'm sure he's rubbing it off her, if that's what you mean. Yeah. And he just said, listen... It's gonna happen. I may be inside you. Let's see where it goes. With Tommy at work, Lisa's mom is over and flippantly mentions she has the breast cancer and abruptly moves on.
Wow.
Lisa feeds her mother the lie that Johnny got drunk and hit her. How does her mom react? Option A. I just told you I have cancer. Option B. Oh my God, are you okay? Or option C, but Johnny doesn't drink.
Johnny doesn't drink? What are you talking about?
That's you're lying, is he? Option C, thanks, Mom. On the rooftop, a drug dealer demands his money from Denny. The person, not the restaurant. Oh, hey, nice green screen. See, the scenes on the rooftop, they're green screened.
It's not that bad looking. I mean, it's clearly fake, but I didn't think it was atrocious.
I think... time and like the HD transfer hasn't done it any favors, but the first scene was fine, but then when they get into later scenes it looks kind of progressively worse.
Definitely. Yeah.
After the scumma whips out his gun, Johnny and Mark intervene just in time and shuffle him off to the police station.
What the fuck was going on here? There's been no mention of Denny's drug problem. If anything, he's like a closet rapist. He's not a drug dealer. He's not a drug taker. Like, where the fuck did this come from?
Complete nonsense. It was just clearly, I put it in there for an exciting scene, a dramatic, you know,
it's
action
so
scene.
Tommy can comfort him, you know, because the women are attacking him and shouting at him, and Tommy, oh, come here. Mm.
Look, he's a great guy.
He is a great guy.
Yeah, we like
super,
him.
Super duper guy.
Oh, by the way, later on, we see that Tommy has the gun in his apartment. He kept the drug dealer's gun.
Ah.
But that means that they literally got this lad and brought him to the police station in, you know, 30 seconds. Not with what evidence?
Yeah.
Well, the cops would all know Johnny because he's a great guy.
Yeah. Just take his word for it.
Yeah.
Hey. Bye-bye.
But the writing and acting here is just atrocious.
It's particularly bad, but Denny says, don't worry about it. That phrase was used at least 60 times in this movie.
Hey, don't worry about it.
You and I want you to splice. Can you do a don't
worry about it? Single.
Can you
one
splicey all the don't worry about it into one, please?
Oh. Hey.
Don't worry about it. Don't worry about those fuckers.
Look, don't worry about it. Look, don't worry about it.
Don't worry about it.
Don't worry about that. Denny, don't worry about it.
Don't worry.
Don't worry about it.
Don't worry about it.
Don't worry about me.
Don't worry.
Don't worry about it, man.
Don't worry about Johnny.
Lisa, the insatiable whore, hounds Mark with proclamations of her love. He responds with, what are you talking about? I just saw you. So, two of Lisa's mates, Michelle and Mike, break and enter into their gaff.
What the fuck? Like, I didn't know what was going on. I thought maybe, just maybe, this is like a movie room and they somehow got the tapes from two different movies mixed up and this random scene got into it. It's out of place. It's out of tone. It's completely out of character with everything that's going on. This is like a bad comedy movie. Yeah. This is the most unsexy sex. Like, if I was trying to bang a bird and she's shoving Belgian chocolates in my mouth, spit in their face. What are you doing?
You see, before the blowjob, he's already orgasming. He's like, oh, yes. Then it happens. Tommy finds out about what Lisa said about him hitting her. In the scene of his career, delivers these iconic lines.
I did not hit her. It's not true. It's bullshit. I did not hit her. I did not.
Oh, hi, Mark.
Johnny is fucking pissed that Lisa has had the gall to say that he hit him. Oh, hi, Mark.
Bullshit. I did not hit her. I did not. Oh, hi, Mark.
It's amazing.
Like, who walks into an area without knowing who's there saying, oh, I did not commit that crime, and this is a crime. I did not molest those children. I swear I didn't. Because the first thing the people are going to think is, he fucking did it,
yeah. Oh, my goodness.
I think we need a song about not diddling kids.
Diddly do, don't diddle kids.
Only the innocents would sing a song about diddling kids.
Only the innocents.
By the way, that iconic scene, 32 takes.
That was the best one.
It was the best one.
Jay? Part time. That was awesome. It's like the best impression of that ever.
Part time.
Thank you.
Proving he's an alien, Wiseau responds to a story about a woman getting beaten up and hospitalized by... What a story.
I used to know a girl. She had a dozen guys. One of them found out about it, beat her up so bad she ended up in a hospital on Guerrero Street.
What a story, Mark.
Yeah, you can say that again.
I'm so happy I have you as my best friend, and I love Lisa so much.
Is he human? It's a bit suspicious. If I was like, spot the alien in human skin, it'd be like,
yeah,
he's the guy with the hair, and he's like, oh, I don't have a friend in the world.
Yeah, so Mark starts asking Johnny, do women cheat as well? And then just starts talking about Lisa. It's like, put two and two together, mate. You know, Mark, like, Tommy obviously thinks he's a great guy and he wrote a movie that shows him as a great guy, but also as a thick guy.
As with the drug addiction storyline, along with the breast cancer storyline and other subplots, they're completely dropped. Denny professes his love for Lisa. Good guy Johnny says that's okay because he trusts them both. And Denny says, okay, I'll marry my girlfriend Elizabeth instead.
Great.
All right.
Yeah.
All right. Kind of paralyzed in disbelief at this writing.
I've no words for it.
There's no point in even complaining about it.
Yeah.
It's gone way too far past that.
And the cosmic ballet goes. The lads play the closest game of catch in the corner.
They call it football. They don't call it a game of catch.
Yes.
They call it football. That's not football.
But it's actually more like a game of pass the parcel because they're right next to each other. Yeah. Did you write that down? Pass the fucking parcel. Get in.
Do you want to explain pass the parcel?
Pass the parcel is like a game you play at like Christmas or birthdays where you put a present in a box and then wrap it multiple times and then you pass it around to music. Stop the music. One person takes off the outermost layer. Keep going until someone gets to the prize.
It's a great game as a kid. Like the prize is always a bit shit because it's small.
It's small.
Yeah. It's
smart.
Yes, the lads play the closest game of pass the parcel in the corner of a fake alleyway for about 15 seconds. Did you know, despite almost the entire film taking place in either Johnny's living room, a bedroom, or the green screen rooftop, the movie costs how much?
300,000.
Oh, yeah, son of a bitch. I was just about to say $250,000.
6 million.
Fuck right off.
Why so expensive? One reason is constructing sets like this fake alleyway, despite them filming in a real alleyway later.
Oh, my God.
Also, Wiseau reshot the same scenes, like with Denny and the drug dealer, in different locations, on different sets.
Vital link to the plot of this movie and to the Denny character.
And the big one, not knowing the difference between 35mm and HD film, Wiseau had two separate crews filming in both simultaneously.
But hold on, I'm sure DVD and Blu-ray sales have been through the roof.
Oh, now he's made it back now, like, yeah. Yes, where'd he get the money? Like Evolution, it's a mystery. He wouldn't say, apart from real estate and importing leather jackets from Korea. Back home, Lisa admits her infidelity to her mother. The characters pick holes in the film's own dialogue. I slept with another guy. Who would you sleep with? I don't want to talk about it. Then why'd you bring it up? Despite Johnny overhearing all of this, he still wants proof, so he takes his magic cassette tape out of his top pocket and rigs up an answering machine to record the next week of conversations somehow on one 45-minute side.
This scene... Oh my God. Tommy Wiseau has to show you it in painstaking detail, step by step. It takes about 2 minutes of movie time to set up this video, this tape recorder. Why? It's so superfluous. It's not needed at all.
Yeah. Maybe he's like, this is the forefront of technology. People won't understand.
Tapes.
They won't get it.
I mean, like, it was 2003. I'm pretty sure you could have just had, like, at least some form of mini disc. It would have been slightly mini-disc. More.
And he just presses play on it as well.
Oh. He doesn't press record.
No, he just presses play. And when he takes it out, it's at the start of the tape. That's bollocks, so it didn't tape anything.
I can't confront her. I want to give her a second chance. After all, she's my future wife. You know what they say, love is blind.
Knowing his future wife was unfaithful, Tommy confides in a guy who can actually wear a suit, Peter. Tommy recounts how himself and Lisa met, which is the story of how he met his actual cheating ex-fiancé. It includes how Johnny was unable to cash an out-of-state check. Johnny, the successful banker, can't cash a check. Mm. Bollocks. I don't think he's really a banker, you know.
Yeah.
With his fucking samurai cop wig. Who's going to hire you? Who would let him near any prospective clients?
Yeah. Yeah.
With the way he talks to people.
Yeah.
How's your sex life?
How dare you? I stopped using the words Johnny and just change over to Tommy, because this movie is about Tommy as a human and not Johnny the character.
Do you think this happened to Tommy? I think so,
yeah, and he's just getting it out of his system.
I don't think it happened quite like the movie.
Well, no, because the movie wouldn't be made then, you know?
Yeah.
Lisa!
Very good, Steve, very good. He asked for advice about Lisa. You're a psychologist, tell me. You're always playing psychologist with us.
Oh my God.
Hey, are you running Beta Breakers this year?
I am, sure. No, I'm not doing it this year. Chicken, Peter, you just a little chicken.
Chip, 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 chip.
You're a chicken. Chip, 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 chip. Cock, 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 cock,
cock, cock, cock, cock, cock. Oh God, my ankle.
Has anyone ever seen a chicken?
Peter, the psychoanalyst who is here to help his friend, his advice is simply, Tommy, sometimes life is just hard. What the fuck is that? Honestly.
On the rooftop, Peter the psychologist sees Mark smoking a spliff and cops that he must be sleeping with Lisa. How will this affect Johnny? Despite previously defending her, he now labels Lisa a sociopath, which makes Mark temporarily try to kill him. besides that being ridiculous, dickhead, stoners don't get furious and murderous.
Thank you. If you wanted to have Mark fly off the handle and get furious at something someone said, don't have him smoke a spliff. Have him drink a bottle of Southern Comfort. Yeah. Anything, literally any other drug in the world.
Yeah, just do a line of coke, like.
Yeah.
Alcohol.
Yeah, booze is the best, yeah.
It's the opposite of how it works. Yeah, like cannabinoids, repressed fucking neurotransmitter release. Shut the fuck up.
Yeah.
Anyway, they both instantly forget the attempted murder and amicably walk off. In tuxedos at Johnny's, the lads swoon over Mark's new shave. This part was put in just so Johnny could call him Babyface, which is Wiseau's nickname for the actor.
Oh. So they're in their tuxes, or what are they doing here? What?
Yeah, the day happens, and then they get coffee the next day. This wasn't a wedding day.
No. Like, was it ever explained? Were they going for, like, a wedding rehearsal or something like that?
I could understand if they were at the shop trying on the suits, getting measured. No.
Or even in the gaff, have an extra person who just has a tape measure and call him a tailor. Boom.
There's nobody else around.
You're so...
Black lads from Samurai Cop. Where are you?
Get in there.
But of course, what do you do when you're wearing a tuxedo? What's the first thing you do, obviously?
You pass the parcel.
You pass the parcel in an alley.
What's the matter, Steve? You too chicken to play catch in your tuxedo?
This scene is obviously a masterpiece, you know, and it needed to be in the movie. The film is not, it's not like it needed filler. It's 1 hour 39 minutes long.
Far too long.
It was a long movie.
It was. It felt obviously a lot longer than it was.
Yeah.
And it's happened to me before watching a shit movie. You pause it. I have to finish. I've started, so I'll finish. I'd rather like look at the wall for a while. You know, like...
It's that old cabin fever.
Maybe that is the room.
Have we just unlocked this movie right now? That's it. Preview's over, lads. Tune in next month.
Why is their horsing around so unnatural?
Yeah. It's so bad.
It's so and they're forced. All like,
they're so supportive. Yeah, man. Great throw. Great catch. You know, like, he's 5 feet away. He can't miss.
Go long. Stretch!
And, like, with the pillow fighting and stuff like that.
Yeah.
The scene ends abruptly as the psychologist slips.
So,
a Freudian slip.
Whoop.
With Johnny at the bank, Mark is free to plough Lisa in his bed.
Song number 3. In your eyes, I can see you are the one for me. This was my personal favorite.
It was so nice. And I love you, Lisa. You can see that in her eyes.
Is he talking
to the reflection of himself?
In her eyes?
Yes.
Ooh,
wow. Oh, it's deep. This shit is deep.
Oh, hi, main event. It's Johnny's birthday. Lisa is cleaning the gaff, resentful but still willing to throw her future husband a surprise party. Her one note of direction in the scene is, take out one piece of food and say a line. Aha, this is my line. That's my second line. This film follows a pattern. Lisa sex scene, Lisa chats to her mother, play catch. Lisa sex scene, Lisa chats to her mother, play catch. It's just slightly different each time. It's like watching Raw. So after the third Lisa sex scene, Lisa chats to her mother. With no new information, fuck it. Her mother does a 360, brother. Telling her not to throw her life away by marrying Johnny. I thought, like, Lisa's character she is one-dimensional, self-destructive, and inconsistent. She both vilifies and protects Johnny to her friends.
Yes.
Surprise!
Surprise! At the party, Wiseau's one directing note was, "Everyone's having a great time. React by laughing to a joke that isn't told." Because everyone's like, it's ridiculous.
It's like, you know, the classic scene in Goodfellas when they're doing like this, the one shot, the continuous shot going through the kitchen into the restaurant. This was like Tommy's version of that, you know, wasn't it? Just going around the party like.
Oh my god.
You have your mate, or what's his name, Mike, gurning again, like she's eating cake and he's finding it arousing. Completely unnecessary. These characters do not need to be built up. They don't even need to exist.
No.
And then Peter, notable by his absence.
Yes, yes. The actor had said, "Listen, I've got whatever, 3 weeks to film this movie. It's not done, tough shit." And it's like, "I'm out of here. I got a new job." That's the end of Peter the Psychologist.
Wow. Well, it's the end of said actor. Like, Peter is still in the scene.
He took his jacket and tie as well. Lisa ushers everyone out for fresh air so she can make out with Mark on the couch.
And he says, "You planned this all along." So this isn't really a master plan, is it? Here, go outside.
It worked, didn't it?
She didn't have blueprints that she is, you know, fucking, you know, scanning for a day. Like, it doesn't take a genius. Like,
if you're going to move, like, the entire party outside, you should probably have something planned. You should have, like, some kind of fireworks display, or maybe, you know, a band is out there, something.
And then she says, "I have something to show you." What? What are you, like, you're kissing him?
Penis.
His own penis. Hey, look at that. Look at the state of it.
Of course, they get caught by some never before seen friend, Stephen. His acting is fucking atrocious. Yeah. Holy God.
Oh my God.
What's going on here? Why are you doing this? I don't believe it.
You don't understand anything, man. Leave your stupid comments in your pocket.
What's going on here? You're going to destroy Johnny. Leave your stupid comments in your pocket. The most used. I have to say, like, Johnny talks in catchphrases as well. Most of them are, but they're all lines. They're all quotes, you know?
Yeah.
So this film is a quotable film. Holy shit. Johnny drops the bombshell that Lisa is expecting, but it's immediately dropped. There is no baby.
We're expecting.
There is no baby.
What?
Lisa just said it to make it interesting and because she's a heel.
To make things interesting. It's the
nasty. Like, this is beyond heel. This isn't just plain unnecessary.
This is evil. Like, yeah, this is... Like, quit playing games with my heart. My heart. Aloha, Aaron.
So they go back in, and then Mark and Lisa are talking, and she slaps him. And then that's when Johnny comes over and says, "Hey, what the hell is going on here?" And then it essentially comes out then at that point that, yeah, these two are having an affair.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's a bit of pushing.
And then Johnny is like, "Okay, I'm a great fucking guy. Mark, I am sorry for you cheating with my girlfriend. And let's make up and shake hands."
And then he says, "Here, Lisa, can we go and talk?" Bang. Cut.
Scene transition.
Bing bong. So time lapse.
Time lapse.
4 seconds have passed.
And then Lisa and Mark, who everyone knows now, canoodling, dancing at his birthday party in his gaff, and everyone else is just kind of...
Yeah, and they're lost in each other's eyes, and she's like rubbing the back of his head, and everyone's just
God. And then Johnny, the complete idiot, comes out, what's going on?
Wait, was he outside that entire time? He said, Lisa, let's go outside.
Yeah, she just closed the door.
Don't touch me, motherfucker. Get out.
You're gonna ruin the party.
If you keep your girl satisfied, she won't come to me.
Get out of my house.
I kill you, I bring him in front of everybody.
Stop it!
I kill you, you bastard.
You could kill me if you tried.
You betrayed me, you're not good. You're just a chicken. Chip, 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 chip.
Shut up!
Shut up!
It's over!
It's not over! Everybody betrayed me. I fed up with this world.
So Tommy comes back in. Yeah. And we resume the scene.
Yeah, let's pretend the last 8 seconds haven't happened.
It all comes out, yeah.
It's already come out. Yeah. They put back in and then they take it out again.
Did he just not face turn with Johnny and shake his hand and they said everything was okay and moved on? Yeah. Let's do the time again. It's all over the place.
Wiseau's acting here goes supernova.
Oh, more cheap as well.
The word's having a laugh, but doing it in a serious fight is, I don't know what you're trying.
At this point, he's fighting for his own honor and the honor of the woman who I imagine he still wants to marry. He still sees a future for the two of these guys. And a cheap, 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 cheap. Blah, blah. Like, what the?
Cuckoo ka-cha. Cuckoo ka-cha.
Cuckoo ka-cha.
Look, I haven't found the right girl. When I do, I will ask her out. Has anyone in this family ever even seen a chicken?
Oh. Yeah, confirming he's actually an alien, he shouts, everyone betrayed me. I'm fed up with this world. I love his delivery. It's lifeless, but there's like one sentence that's an outburst and it's back to lifeless.
Yeah.
I've never seen anything like it.
It's almost like he's, as an actor, he can't let go, and he gets these fleeting moments of where he's able to do it, but then he gets like self-conscious and reins it all back in again or something. Like, just, he may be the worst actor I've ever seen.
You are lying. I nearly hit you. You are tearing me apart, Lisa!
Why are you so hysterical?
Do you understand life? Do you? Why, Lisa? Why?
Stankin'. There are no other words. This is awfulness.
Betrayed, we get the incredible, slowest house trashing full of shit props in history. It's amazing. The glasses smash when he just touches them. They don't hit the ground and smash, they just smash. He picks up an empty TV, throws it horizontally at the window, and it falls down.
Dropped vertically down. And there's a part where he's taking the presses out of like a cabinet, and he's just like so lackadaisical. He's like leaning on top of it and just going, meh, meh, meh. Oh my god.
It's incredible. It's the slowest, lowest energy smash the room up.
It's shockingly bad. It's like he just can't act. He can't act like a man who's lost it. Cannot do it.
Well, I'll tell you what he can do. Explicitly rub himself with Lisa's red dress. he is.
It actually gets even better. So Johnny keeps the gun in like a wooden box. And when he goes to pick it up, the box flops open. Obviously, like, this wasn't meant to happen. So as he picks it up, he closes it and then reopens it to be like, my gun. could you not have done this twice? This.
One take,
5 seconds.
Johnny puts a gun in his mouth and kills himself. Now you'll all see what you've done.
So he blew his brains out.
Yeah.
Sometime later, Mark finds him and tells him to wake up.
To the man with the hole in his head.
Is he dead? Is he dead? Yeah. Mark, is he dead? I was like, I've got my fingers in the hole in the back of his head. Pretty sure he is.
He's like doing like a ventriloquist act. Yes, I'm dead.
Weekend at Tommy's.
Mark turns heel on Lisa, saying it's all her fault. And now it's Denny's turn to grieve as the three console each other as police sirens intensify. Curtains down.
And Denny, the big thing was Denny. He was left without his father. He's probably going to go back on the drugs. Who's getting the apartment? The room, if you will. Who's getting
it? Was it bought or was he renting it?
After all that smashy, I hope he owned it.
Well, then again, though, who's going to chase him down for payments? Like,
Tommy, I'm sorry, Lester. Oh, you're a great guy. Go on. All right, let's take it to the aftermath. So, as you can see, the film's a complete mess. Wiseau originally wrote this as a stage play, which partially explains why the film takes place in basically three sets, one of which is a green screen. That didn't work, and he also failed to get it published as a book, so self-financed it to become a movie.
A book. Wow. I can actually see this working as a play.
And acting tends to be shit in plays, in my opinion.
It tends to be hammy, doesn't it?
Hammy. Because you need to project through the whole room, you know?
Yes, marketing for the movie was pretty much a single LA board with his face, one eye in mid-blink as well.
No.
Which cost $5,000 a month for 5 years, i.e. $300,000. Its initial theatrical run brought in a whopping $1,800, or 11 days hiring a billboard. So, what'd you make of the film?
Well, of course, like, it was one of the worst movies I've ever seen. Because it's better than Date Movie. There's a few bits I enjoyed, like, especially Tommy at the end, pre-smashy-smashy, when he's sitting in the armchair.
Real human emotions, lads.
I don't know what else one could say. I mean, it's fucked. I mean, as a movie, it's fucked. But I'll watch the review. Absolutely. And I'll probably watch the review several times.
Right. Man, I don't really know where to start. It's like, in some ways, this is a better movie than Samurai Cop. It has more of a budget, has slightly better acting and continuity.
Real hair.
Real hair for the entirety of said movie. But it's also way worse. It's like, it takes itself so seriously. This is not made in tongue-in-cheek. This tries to be a real fucking powerhouse, heavy-hitting movie. And it fails on every possible level. But like, what got me more was just the wild swings in tone. Like the scene where Johnny is talking to Peter. And then just weird thrown-in scenes, like the Denny drug dealer gun scene. Like, this has no place in this movie. Passing parcels. I don't even know how to score this movie. It's so all over the place. I've never seen a movie that doesn't know what it is as much as this. But in saying that, everyone should watch this movie at least once. I'm a loss for words. I don't know.
10 on 10. 10 on 10. Technically, the film is shot and it's framed fine. There's even a few panning handheld camera shots. The sets are kind of shabby, but they're passable. But the writing, the dialogue, the screenplay, the acting is atrocious. There's several subplots of all the B characters, all of which go unresolved. This film is a steaming pile of shit, by an idiot who's simultaneously incredibly pretentious. He had to replace the entire crew twice. He fired the actor who played Mark on the first day, and his assistant slash buddy Greg stepped in. Same with Lisa. The actress cast was a much older Latina, but left and one of her understudies took her place. Same with Michelle. Wiseau originally intended to have his own subplot where Johnny's a vampire and travels in his flying car.
10 on 10. I would have loved. Now, if that had been added to this movie, it would have changed everything, because then it becomes tongue-in-cheek and then you can go along with it and have a laugh. Mm-hmm. Sequel, lads. I know he's dead. I know he's a vampire. It's Grant.
Yeah, as you said, everyone should see this at least once, just to see this work of art. This is like you've made some kind of Sistine Chapel out of shit. Yeah. You know, it's quite impressive, you know. Yeah, one thing's for sure, yeah. Tommy Wiseau is a great guy.
He is a stand-up lad.
Ooh, what became of The Room? After release, its big break in cult status rose when Adult Swim played it on loop for April Fool's 2009.
Awesome. Awesome, awesome, awesome.
From there, it snowballed with riff tracks picking it up, Patton Oswalt and a host of celebrities being fans, Nostalgia Critic reviewing it, and so much so, it has showings once a month across America, and Wiseau has gone worldwide attending screenings, Rocky Horror Picture Show style, where people dress up as their favourite characters, throw around footballs, that kind of thing.
Shit, everyone just wears tuxes. It's grand.
The video game snippets you've seen throughout the video are from the 2010 The Room Tribute Flash game by Newgrounds. You gotta play it. It's great. And at the end of it, Tommy Wiseau, Johnny, he gets beamed up to his spoon-shaped alien starcraft.
Yes! Yeah, his people need him.
But what of The Room actors? Robin Paris, a.k.a. Michelle, has spearheaded a successful Kickstarter for a Room mockumentary featuring the main cast, apart from Tommy Wiseau and, oh hi Mark, Greg Sestero.
Except for the main two.
Why not Mark? He's under a no-compete for The Room for similar The Room projects, as he wrote a book about the making of The Room called The Disaster Artist and successfully auctioned it to James Franco to be made into a movie. Which started filming in December 2015. Hmm. And Wiseau, what is Tommy Wiseau up to? He is busy promoting Samurai Cop 2.
Oh, yeah. The two greatest hairstyles in cinema history collide.
It looks amazing. It looks like he said, listen, I'm only doing one take and that's it.
Because he's a pro.
It's Matthew Caritas and Tommy Wiseau together at last. Yeah. But that's for another day. Hopefully.
But I believe the love is one continuous stream, which is never ends.
So that does it for this week, folks. Footballs were thrown, flowers were bought, and belly buttons were penetrated. Hope you've enjoyed our special Brucie bonus episode on The Room. We have our Golden Nogger Awards and Q&A before we launch our new storyline. Huge thanks to Tyler, aka Gamebox, of the Invasion Podcast.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Don't forget to pick up our brand new Fight Tee from tshirt.oswreview.com. You can catch all of our episodes, free of charge, and an IMAX flavored 4:3 full screen. So it's a goodbye from OZ.
Peru.
MV1.
Peekaboo.
And myself, Jay Hunter. And remember. Cheep, cheep, cheep. Can we get a cheep, cheep, cheep? Cheep, 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 cheep. Steve, we gotta get in on the cheeps.
I haven't seen that episode.
No. This is off this movie.
Yeah, I know.
You know.
It's like fucking Roadrunner. I have the copy of Base Cheap. Give me one cheap. I couldn't have gone any better.
A winner is you.